This conference will now be recorded.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to ESA Training Solutions. This is Roshan here. So I am here with a demo session on cloud performance engineering in DevOps. Okay, so let's get started. This is something about me. So I have around 14 years of experience, more than 14, into IT industry and predominantly into performance engineering, Java and Python development. I'm also a certified architect associate cloud professional. I have been doing automation in Java, Python, Terraform, Ansible, PL/SQL, Self Scripting, Selenium. Currently working as a principal SRE and performance engineering and DevOps professional. So this will be the agenda of our discussion today. We'll start with a question, and I would like you to think about that question, the answer of that question, and then we'll go about software development and deployment evolution, how software has been evolved, developed, and deployed over the period of time. So, and course syllabus, we'll understand the course syllabus here, and we'll set the expectations that what you should expect from this course, and what will I learn by end of this course. So you will have that, and then we'll have Q&A session. Okay, so to start with this question, I assume that most of us are here are performance testers, performance engineers, few performance managers and architects as well, and then we have folks who want to learn into DevOps field, who are aspirant in DevOps. That's what I assume, and the about my audience, and I pose this question to them, to everyone in this forum right now, that are any performance testers or engineers are expected to know this, like the know this means that the terms like DevOps, the microservices, containers, and cloud. Do we really need to know this as a performance tester, engineer, architect, the managers, or a DevOps professional? Do we need to know this? So you can answer this on your own. I'm going to straight away to talk about into the software development and deployment evolutions. Once we understand this picture here, you would know the answer of the last question. Okay. So this is how the software has been developed and deployed over the evolved, the development and deployment has been evolved over a period of time. So let me get the ledger. Okay. So to start with here, back in 1980s, when the software development started, we started with waterfall model, right? We started with waterfall model as part of the development process. Then on the architecture side, we were building monolithic applications. When I say monolithic, so all your logic resides in only one server. That's what monolithic means. And then we were hosting our applications, small application to a bigger physical server. We were doing that way. And then we had data centers. If people wanted to deploy their application, develop their application, they had to set up this data center on your own. It's a very costly affair. Not every company can afford that. Only the financially stable, good companies, they can only be able to take care of the data centers or set up data centers. Right? So this was the case back in 1980s. Software evolved in this period, and then we understand the limitations of waterfall model and monolithic applications, physical servers, and data centers. And it was not cost-effective thing. Not everyone can afford to set up a data center, right? Waterfall model in itself is having a lot of disadvantages, we all know. And then we move to Agile, right? So now here, the software development were done in the part of phases, different phases. We carried out our development activity. So that we don't get here in the case of waterfall, you know, right? We software was developed at once, then we started to test. What if the design is wrong? You cannot do anything about it. What if the performance is not up to the mark? We don't have any idea how to fix it. You have to start over. Those were the situations. So we moved to Agile, And then we divided the software development into various phases. We call them sprints, right? So this is one sprint, this is second sprint, third, fourth. And this is how we went on. On the architecture front as well, we understand that let's not have everything on only one server. You should have a three-tier application, two-tier or three-tier application, depending on your application. And we can architect our solutions there. So basically, three-tier is what people recommend mostly, like application server, database, and the web server, right? And then we understood that why are we wasting so much of physical server if we can virtualize the same physical server and create multiple VMs. So now I can use the same hardware, underlying hardware, and I can create multiple VMs, and I can deploy many more applications. I can use the resource efficiently, much more efficiently than the physical server deployment, the way we are doing. And then there were a few companies who started to offer like hosting, hardware hosting, right? So they started to offer in around 2000, right? So now you don't need to set up the complete data center. You can basically leverage someone else's hardware and you can host your application. This was the situation. But now the current trend, where we are into DevOps phase. We understood that there are limitations of agile methodology as well. Not completely, but there are companies where this development and operations may suffer most of the time, development team and the operations team. The developer develops in one environment, operations means testing team and the support team, they test, they operate in some other environment. Not sure if production gets the same kind of environment variables or the plugins or whatever required. So there was a lot of lag. There's a lot of lag between development and operations team. So what it does that it slows down the deployment process. So to overcome that, this DevOps has come into picture where every step is automated. So as soon as the developer checks in the code to a central repository, let's say GitHub, the code will get automatically built. Earlier there was a manual process. The developer used to build the code for the compile time error or the runtime error. Now I want to automate everything so that I can deploy my application swiftly, in a very swift manner, very quickly to production. I get to test as well. I get to do everything, whatever I was doing in Agile, but I have automated the entire process. Okay, and that is the way I am trying to make my deployment much more quicker. Okay, so once the developer checks in the code has to get built, and then it has to get deployed to the testing environment. Then all the testing should happen, and then if testing passes, then the code should go to production. Those kind of things. We are automating everything here in the DevOps, and this is where the current trend is. People are trying to migrate to the DevOps. And from N-tier, we are moving towards microservices. We understood the importance, the disadvantages with monolithic applications, large applications. It is a risk to application availability and reliability. Even if one of the module, let's say in monolithic big application, right? Even if a small part is not working, its code, somehow there is a bug into the system. In some one of the modules, it can impact the overall availability of the application. That is why we are moving towards microservices. Even if one module goes down or we have issues with one module, your entire application will not go down. Only that particular module will have problem, but you can carry on with other your activity. Like for example, we have Swiggy app or Ola Uber app. We use those app to book a cab. There are notifications icon at the top. If notifications icon doesn't work properly, when you order a cab or when you book a cab, when you book a cab, you get a notification that yes, you have successfully booked the cab. If notification I call is not working properly. Does it mean that you cannot book a cab? That's the example of microservices, that even if one functionality doesn't work, it doesn't let you block the other functionality. That's the importance of microservices, right? And it because of that, your system is highly available and reliable, right? So that's the microservices we are moving towards. So that's the trend right now. From 2010, people have been migrating from Agile to DevOps. There are companies still, they're like old legacy companies, old legacy product. They are into Agile, so they are continue to be in Agile. Very difficult for them to move to DevOps now. But nowadays, whatever the startups are coming, any new development is coming, they are all into microservices and DevOps. And lastly, where do we run these microservices? We have microservices, so we run them in containers. So here in this section is all about efficient resource utilization. Back in 1980s, we were using big physical server. Around 2000, so we understood that so we are not able to utilize the resource better, efficiently. So we split the same physical server into VMs. But again, now what we are doing in the same virtual machine, I can create multiple containers. So basically, if it's a three-tier application, I needed three VMs: one for the app server, one for the web server, one for the database server. But now, because of these containers, in the same VM, in the one VM, I can have three containers. One container for app server, one container for web server, and another container for database server. So I'm able to utilize the resource much more efficiently. It's all about the resource efficient utilization. That's all I'm doing, we have been doing, because that is very costly, right? If I can manage my application availability and reliability, and that too with a less storage, a less resource utilization, that's nothing like it, right? So that's the best scenario possible. And then we are into cloud phase now. Most of the companies have started to offer their services, like Amazon Web Services, AWS is there, Azure is there, GCP is there, DigitalOcean is there, Oracle Cloud is there, IBM's, Alibaba. There are a lot of cloud providers now in the market where you can go and rent your hardware, okay, and you can host your application there. You don't need to purchase the hardware. What in the case of data center, right? You had to purchase the, if you want to set up a data center, what you have to do? You have to purchase the land first, acquire the land. Then you have to construct infrastructure, building, cooling mechanism, very costly affair. You need to, on the security of your data center, you have to invest. And then you have to maintain the data center. That's a huge costly affair. But now, these AWS, Azure, GCP, Oracle Cloud, IBM, Alibaba, DigitalOcean, what they're doing, they have the infrastructure with them. And they want you to leverage their hardware, their resource. And they would just ask for some rent on behalf of whatever you have asking for, right? So it's such an easy thing. So nowadays, that's why you see more startups coming up, and they can easily just provision few servers and they can deploy their application, and their application is up and running and their business is up and going, right? So that's how this current trend is: DevOps, microservices, containers, and cloud. So now I'll go back to my previous slide. So our performance engineers are expected to know this. I would not say performance, I would say everyone in IT has to know this, because this is the trend. If you do not know, if you understood waterfall, if you understood Agile, but if you do not understand DevOps, you'll be lagging behind. Similarly, if you have worked on monolithic applications, but nowadays all the companies are developing microservices. If you don't understand about microservice architecture, where do we run microservices? It will be difficult for you to even crack the interview, right? And containers, these containers is where the microservices run, right? That's the runtime environment of containers. Then it will now later phase. I'll talk about container engine and container orchestration engine, where I'll talk about Kubernetes and pods. All things are related. And now the cloud. If I talk about the infrastructure, on-prem most of the companies, legacy company, if they have on-prem infrastructure, well and good. Even if they have on-prem infrastructure, they are also moving to the cloud because they understand why to keep maintaining their on-prem infrastructure. If they can get leverage the same hardware to the cloud, so they are using the cloud. So this is expected, right? So you guys being in IT, everyone, me, you, everyone needs to know about this technology. There is no doubt in that. So that's the brief I wanted to cover before I jump into the course syllabus, because my course syllabus revolves around all these four topics. I have made sure that's the course topic is all about. Okay, so let's get started with the course topic. Okay, so on the cloud front, okay, I mentioned about four stuff. On the cloud front, we have AWS. Okay, I'm covering AWS. From scratch, okay, that's the word I am using. That's my tagline I use, from scratch. If you do not have any knowledge, good, no problem. We have you covered. So on the cloud front, I will be going through AWS. I'll take one cloud service provider. It doesn't mean that I'm not going to talk about Azure or GCP. If you know one cloud service provider, it's easy to relate, understand, learn other cloud service providers. Mostly the name changes. Okay, I'll talk about it. I don't want to go in detail right now because there would be people who would be new to the cloud and they may not relate things. But once I go start the AWS topic and I'll take the reference of Azure and GCP and you would know. Okay, so similar service exists. So if you want to provision and EC2 instance, let's say server. So in EC2, in AWS, they call it instances, okay. But in case of Azure, the name changes, okay. They call it VMs, okay. They call it servers. In Oracle calls it compute. So only the name changes, okay. So similar stuff, okay. So if you know one cloud service provider, you can learn easily other cloud service providers. So when I say AWS, it doesn't mean I'm just covering AWS. You would know Azure and GCP as well. So I'll maintain that. So no need to worry that I'm just covering AWS, not Azure and GCP. Not possible to cover everything, but you would know how things work in Azure and GCP as well. Second, a Linux command line. A very important topic. Most of us are working in Linux operating system all the time, right? All the time we work Linux operating system. We don't deploy our application in Windows. Hardly we do that. Okay. I have a Windows laptop. I log into Windows laptop and then I just use entire day on the Linux box I spend. That's how most of us are doing it, right? So the understanding of Linux command line, the self-scripting is very important because this Linux command line and self-scripting helps you a lot. If you are comfortable with Linux the way you are with Windows, right? If I ask you in Windows, where is in under D drive, how many folders are there, right? If I ask you, you can easily tell. You can go to D drive and you can just list all the folders. But what if I ask you the same thing in Linux? It's just an operating system, nothing else. If I ask you how many directories instead of folder, how many directories are there in that particular directory or mount, whatever. So you should be in a position to answer me that and how to navigate, who is the user who is logged in, if I ask you that. So we log into Windows, right? We know this is the user who has logged in. But what if I ask you the same question in Linux? Who is the user who is working on this? The file permissions, a lot more things. So we'll be covering the Linux command line. I'll go over the detailed syllabus right now, okay, in just a short while. So Linux command line we are covering. We'll be covering about the software application architecture, the microservices, how it is architected, and how it is different than monolithic applications, and the runtime environment of those microservices run in containers. And to create containers, you need a container engine. Okay, you need to install container engine. to create containers, right? Then the Docker is the container engine here. There are other container engines as well in the market. Docker happens to be the most popular of them. It's just a container engine. What you do on one VM, you install container engine and then you can create containers. So as simple as that. When you have a lot more containers, how do you manage? How do you orchestrate those? Means I want to auto scale my containers, right? If I am from performance background, I need to make sure the performance is good. My application is highly available and reliable. For the performance engineers or testers, aspirants, these non-functional requirements are important, right? Availability, scalability, reliability, performance. That's what we talk about, right? Non-functional requirements, NFRs, we call it, right? So how do you make sure that your application would be highly available, reliable, and performance-wise meeting up the SLAs, and everything? So for that, we have a container orchestration engine like Kubernetes. We leverage Kubernetes, and then we can orchestrate the containers, like load balancing. So automatically, if users are coming in, the load will be balanced across your request, incoming request will be balanced across all the servers. It will be auto-scaled. If there is more users coming in, you want to scale up your servers, right? Scale up, and that to happen automatically. That's, if I have to do it manually, it's a very tedious task, right? I will set up a automatic scaling. Automatically, I would get my servers provisioned and my pods provisioned, right? So that's how I'll go in container orchestration engine, Kubernetes. And last but not the least, DevOps. Right. So I'm covering here the cloud and then the microservices here. And to work with the microservices, containers, Kubernetes, you need to have Linux command line knowledge that will add there. And then DevOps to understand how performance engineering fits in DevOps and to understand about the CI/CD pipeline and where performance engineers come into picture to create CI/CD pipeline using Jenkins. CI tools, Jenkins is the continuous integration tool. It has a lot of plugins and to create, how do we create pipeline and how do we create performance jobs? Because it's all about automating stuff and we can automate all this activity using any continuous integration tool like Jenkins. So that would be our course syllabus here. For this, and this would go for about it's a lot. Since I'm covering from scratch, I assume that my audience doesn't have any knowledge at all. I assume that way, very freshers. Since I take up of those aspects as well, so this course would go around 40 to 45 hours easily. It can go for 2 months, and I take up this every day on weekdays. The course we go very slow in the initial part. Once we are comfortable with everything, then we start to ramp up. Okay, so that's how I go. So let's go over the detailed syllabus, okay, on each of these topics. So coming to the cloud computing, right? So these are all the syllabus that I'm covering in cloud computing. As you can see, starting from the basics of cloud computing. Even if you do not have any prior knowledge, good, no worries. If you have knowledge, that is also even better. You would learn something more. So, and you can appreciate things better, right? Once I explain and go over the things. So cloud computing, why do we need? What is cloud computing? The service models that we have. What is infrastructure as a service? What do we mean by platform as a service? What do we mean by software as a service? Deployment models. We have public, private, hybrid deployment models. We'll go ahead and create AWS account, and that's how we will learn. How do you do budget setup and core cloud concept? First of all, we understand what this region mean and availability zone means. If you're new to it, I am one of the security services in AWS, IAM, identity and access management, we call it. How do we provision EC2 instances? We'll understand about all the security here, security groups, NACL rules, and how do you store storage services AWS provides, the networking, VPC, the most important of it, VPC. Basically, we will architect solution in cloud. After going through this this session, you can architect solution securely. That's what more important, right? You want to architect solution because you would be, as a performance engineer, you would be working in some architecture, right? You would go over architecture if they have implemented in any cloud service provider. And if you do not understand these words like storage services like EBS, EFS, or S3, it will be not possible to understand the architecture completely. If you're using VPC, terms like private subnet, public subnet, internet gateway, a NAT instance, if you do not understand route table, if you do not understand these words, very difficult for you to understand the software architecture. So that is the region I'm covering from very scratch. And once we understand that, it's the next important topic is the elastic load balancer and auto scaling group. That's very important from a performance point of view. How do you load balance and auto scale automatically? Auto scale, the name itself is auto scale. So how do you make sure that your application, your software implementation, your architecture automatically scales as per the user demand? If there are more hits coming in, your servers should get auto provisioned, right? And if there is no need of that many servers, that should again auto scale down, right? That should get auto scaled down because you don't need that many servers. Why are you wasting resources? So you need to create, we call it CloudWatch alarm for that. You need to take care of the auto scaling policies. So we'll talk about that. It's all in all AWS, and we'll understand about the monitoring. How do you monitor for performance engineers, testers? Very important to monitor the resource utilization. We would be doing that using CloudWatch. That's the out of the box monitoring solution in AWS. Okay, so that's the entire syllabus we have in cloud, right? Then coming to the Linux command line, if someone is very much comfortable in Windows and they're struggling with Linux command line, so here is the opportunity to learn from very basics. So my tagline is simple: get as comfortable with Linux as you are with Windows. I'll make sure that after this course, you would think, okay, it's just an operating system, nothing big it is. You can get all the information, the how, the way you feel comfortable. If I ask you, if you just let me know the number of processes in Windows operating system. So we have worked in Windows, we know. Go to Task Manager, look for all the processes and those stuff, how much CPU utilization each process is taking. If I ask you the same thing in Linux, if you can do that, good. If I can ask you, how can you relate these processes with number of threads? Because that's important, right? So things like that, right? So you need to understand the Linux command line the way I look at it. It's just an operating system. You need to know how to get information from it. That's it. So system information, there are some commands to do that. Hardware information, there are some commands to do that. Performance monitoring and statistics, if you want to understand how the resource utilization, there are a few commands for that. User information and management, file and directory commands, process management, file permissions, networking, how to archive. You zip a file in Windows, right? You can easily zip it, unzip it. Can you do the same thing in Linux? How to do that? How do you install packages? What is CentOS? What is Debian family? What is CentOS family? Is that command changes between Debian family and CentOS family? Sometime I have seen using apt, sometime I see someone using yum. How do they decide when to use what? So basic questions where people struggle most of the time. So that's what I intend to take care from this particular chapter module of this syllabus, Linux command line. Get as comfortable with Linux as you are with Windows. And after the end of it, we'll be learning shell scripting as well. How to do shell scripting. Once you understand the command, how do you do shell scripting? Let's say you do not have any commercial tools, okay? and you're using Linux, and I ask you that if you run a test for 1 hour or 2 hour, I want to capture the CPU memory disk for all your during the test duration. You need to have all the samples with 5 seconds delay, let's say. How would you do that? And how would you analyze it? So for that, you need to write a shell script where you can push the metrics every 5 seconds. And then later you can get that result and you can use Microsoft Excel to plot graphs. Okay. So things like that, very, very useful utility, shell scripting. You can perform, you can automate command and task in shell scripting. In Linux command line, how do you do that, right? So you can automate like same, like batch for Windows, we write batch script, right? So same thing in Linux, we write shell script. So things like that, okay, so we'll be covering that. We'll be talking about software application architecture, the monolithic and the microservices. What do we mean by monolithic application and the microservice architecture? The advantages, disadvantages, and a lot more. Okay, so why are we shifting towards microservices? What is the need, and how, and where do these microservices run? About the Docker container engine, very important stuff, because nowadays, if the implementation is on Docker, let's say containers, and if you're supposed to test, if you're a performance tester. You would get either the UI to test, user interface to test, a web URL, or you would have a API, REST API to test. Either way, you need to know how the software has been architected, and then only you can do a performance testing well. You need to know the architecture to test it better. You need to know the resource utilization of your containers. If your containers is hosted on any particular instance, what is the footprint, the resource utilization of the containers? You need to know that. And what is the bottleneck? How would you look at what are logs you will look at? So things like that. Okay, so we'll understand first the container engine. How do you install a container engine? Then how do you create containers? A lot more things. Docker Compose. So you don't do one by one. You use Docker Compose to spin up all your containers, the entire application stack. You can use Docker Compose to have your app server, web server, database server, all in one YAML file, and you can use Docker Compose to make your application up and running. And it would hardly take 5 seconds to build your application. Such a quick deployment, okay, using Container Engine. We'll talk about so this is the runtime environment of microservices, and here I'll go in detail about the container orchestration engine as well. So the Kubernetes. Okay. So we need to we'll understand the Kubernetes as well. Kubernetes, how in AWS space, how Kubernetes are cluster is created using EKS. EKS is the service we'll be talking about, Elastic Kubernetes Service. And how Kubernetes are architected, cluster is created, and what all things are there. A lot more stuff. So we'll be spending around 2 weeks in Kubernetes only. So once you're comfortable till this point, then only you will be able to understand Kubernetes. So everything is, you need to ramp on. So everything is structured. You need to know cloud knowledge first. You need to be comfortable with Linux. You need to understand the containers. And then only I can introduce Kubernetes to you. If you learn just Kubernetes without knowing all these things, it will be difficult to grasp everything about Kubernetes. So then we'll talk about performance engineering in DevOps. So how performance engineering is integrated in DevOps. What all in the DevOps, what all the life cycle is there. First of all, I'll introduce you with DevOps. The life cycle in DevOps, and then how performance engineering is integrated in DevOps. What all is your activity? Where all your responsibilities are in DevOps as a performance engineer? Tester, fine. So performance testing and engineering, I hope you know that. So performance testing is a subset of performance engineering. Okay. Performance engineering is a much more wide domain. Performance testing is a part in it. Okay. Performance testing is just to make sure to provide load. That's what performance testing is, because I am tuning the application, right? Your entire application, and to make sure that I have tuned it well, I need to do performance test. I hope you understand this. So consider a bigger box of performance engineering and have a small box of performance testing there, because that's what it does. Performance testing helps me validate my tuning or my engineering activities, whatever I'm doing. So if I'm architecting a solution in cloud, right, on the security front or all the front, then I need to do a performance test to make sure that, yes, my architecture is good enough to handle this much of user load with this much of response time, this much of SLA, and highly available reliability, meeting all the NFRs, right? So I hope you guys understand. So performance engineering is a much more wide scope. So performance testing is a part in it, but performance engineering starts from your planning phase itself. When the software is in the planning phase, you need to talk about your non-functional requirements and your architecture and those stuff, the monitoring part as well, okay? Shift left approach and shift right approach, we'll understand that. So that's about the performance engineering in DevOps. And I did talk about container orchestration engine. Once we understand that, we will dive into Kubernetes. The most important of it, I have not seen any interview. I have got many, that's what people inform me. Even I take up the interview, I make sure that people knows about Kubernetes. Even if you are a performance tester or a budding performance engineer, if you do not know how Kubernetes is implemented in cloud, very difficult to crack the interview, because they would expect you. Because nowadays, that's what they are doing. They have understood companies are migrating towards Kubernetes implementation. Because of its highly high availability, high reliable, because Kubernetes is highly available, reliable, and scalable. Okay, because Google, Kubernetes is from Google. I hope you know that. So Kubernetes is from Google, and who handles load better than Google? I don't know anyone. That's because it's coming from the Google family, Kubernetes, and now they have donated Kubernetes to CNCF. Cloud Native Computing Foundation. They have donated, now CNCF takes care of its certification and all. But to have an understanding of Kubernetes is very important. How do you deploy Kubernetes cluster? What is master and what is slave? What is this pod? How do we achieve auto scaling? If there are more users coming in, now I'm showing you that I have three worker nodes, three instances. If I need more instances, how would I make sure that I get servers auto scaled? You see, there are few number of pods here. If the users coming in, how would I make sure that pods get auto scaled? That's how Google has been maintaining their. There are so many people who are accessing Google on daily basis. Everyone does that, right? But they hardly experience sluggish performance. And Kubernetes is the big part in it, because they have implemented their complete setup, most of their applications in Kubernetes. We'll understand about it a lot more. I don't want to go in detail right now. It will be boring for most of us. We'll understand this later. Okay. So I'm covering each and everything here. And then at last, but not the least, the continuous performance testing in DevOps. How do you create CI/CD pipeline? Where your performance job comes into picture. So what you're seeing here, I have taken a direct snapshot from my Jenkins dashboard, where I have created a CI/CD pipeline, once the developer checks in the code to a GitHub repository, let's say I'm calling that a Git job, the codes would get built and deployed to my testing environment. That's what I'm doing in the second job. I have got the code in my testing environment, there are a lot of more testing. QA guys would do their automation testing, but as a performance tester, we need to have this job with us, perimeter job. And once this job is successful, we'll put some our condition criteria. What is the passing criteria and failing criteria, success criteria? And once that is successful, then only your code will be pushed to production. And every process is automated here. There is no manual intervention at all. That's the thing with DevOps. they are making sure that the once the developer finishes, completes writing the code, and they pushes the code to the GitHub or central repository, it takes very less time to have to get that code in production with all those checks in place. All the testing. I'm just showing you one testing here, JMeter job testing, but there are other testing as well. The QA guys would test your application. Okay. And everything. And how do you configure email notifications? A lot more stuff. Okay. And how what AWS has to offer in DevOps. Okay. Things like that. Okay. Okay. So that is the course. Okay. That is the course. So I've covered all those four important topics. The one I started up with: DevOps, microservices, containers, and cloud. This is what I'm targeting here with this course, so that you get end-to-end view of how things are implemented in cloud and from the performance point of view. Coming back to the what will I learn by end of this course? You will learn a lot for sure. It's like my 3 years of experience completely. Last 3 years where I have been working mostly with cloud, 3 to 4 years. I have taken everything and put it here, and I make this course concise. It takes very long time for me to complete, around two and a half months, two to 3 months mostly it takes me to complete, because a lot more things. I assume that my audience doesn't know anything. From very basics, I start up things. So that's the thing. All the topics are covered from very scratch. Okay. No, very scratch. I cannot stress this enough. If you have attended my workshop, I'm not sure how many people have attended, but if you go over that's how I go over all the topics here. So all we need is your enthusiasm to learn. You need to be a good learner, and you need to practice. After I go on with any topic, you'll get the videos, you need to watch the videos, and you need to practice. And okay, so coming back to what will I learn? So the course starts with obviously the core cloud concepts and cloud implementation, which differs from on-prem. So that's there. And then AWS cloud computing and various services. You will learn a lot more services, around 25 to 30 services in AWS. You'll be feeling comfortable. You will feel comfortable now that you know cloud, you know microservices, you know Docker, you know Kubernetes. You can easily crack the interview. There will not be any problem at all. You can also go after attending this course. This will lay a very strong foundation for your certification. You can go with cloud practitioner and solution architect associate certification. I will guide you, because I do not cover the entire thing which they ask. They talk about pricing and a lot more stuff that you get questions on. But I can guide you. But this course will be a very good foundation. You don't need to go and attend any other course to go for certification and all. I can simply guide you that read this, go over this, and you can crack the certification exam. 20 to 25 AWS services, more than that. I have just guessed it. It is much more than that. Architecting, yes, you will learn about architecting resilient, highly available, and fault-tolerant cloud solutions. How do we implement solutions in cloud? After going through this, if someone comes up with the architecture in the cloud, you would be easily looking at it, and you can easily understand what things are being done in cloud. You can easily understand the architecture, and you can test it better. You can performance engineer it better. Okay, so Linux command line that I have mentioned about it, microservices, Kubernetes, CloudWatch, performance in CI/CD pipeline, everything you will be learning here. Okay, I want to give 10 to 15 minutes for you to have questions. Okay, that's all I wanted to cover today. Let me know your questions. If you have any doubts, concerns, let me know. Okay, you can ping me, you can speak also. I'm okay. Okay. I have got one ping from Anil. I request to run the performance scripts in AWS Kubernetes. Yes, you would understand how do you run performance. See, performance scripts means what? You have tools like JMeter or LoadRunner to create performance scripts, right? If you have got one URL, okay? See, Kubernetes Docker is the implementation. You need to understand this, Anil, that Kubernetes and Docker is the implementation. This is where your microservices host, okay? It doesn't mean that your testing would differ. AWS is a place where you get the hardware, where your servers are hosted, AWS. That's what AWS does to you. You need to understand this in picture. So you deploy your server, you provision your server from any cloud service provider, let's say AWS. You can do it from on-prem also, nothing matters, nothing changes. What changes is the security and the implementation that I'll be going over. But the testing wise, nothing changes. Whatever you do in on-prem infrastructure, same thing you do in cloud. If you have got one UI, if you have got one web URL to test, the same thing you would test. Only thing to how do you monitor? How do you monitor if it's implemented in Kubernetes? What all you will monitor? How will you monitor? If it's implemented in containers using Docker, how will you monitor? What all you will monitor? That becomes more relevant. The testing wise, it is the same stuff. If you have a REST API or web URL, it is the same stuff the way you test. Okay. But you will understand these things. Okay. That's what.
Yeah, Roshan bro, I have one doubt.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Yeah, as you mentioned, like that microservices is what we have, right? So we will get as a REST or this one. So currently, for example, we have only the REST. So that means we will get as a GET or a POST, right? So what we'll do in the sense, if for example, if you have a LoadRunner tool, so we will pass it as a web URL, as otherwise we will pass it as a web custom request. So we will make the script ready, but that will be in different data centers, right? So what are all the load generators which will be available, that will be in a different data center. For example, if my application is available in cloud, so is there any effective way we can do a better performance testing, because we will reduce the latency between the data centers which is available?
Obviously, Sun, if that is the case, you install your LoadRunner or JMeter in the same region, in the same availability zone. That is the best thing. If you know that your servers is hosted in this region or this AZ, let's assume that, you can create one Windows instance in that very AZ or region, and you can have your load generators or the master, any for JMeter or your controller there in the same AZ, and you can test it, because your latency would differ. Again, it depends on the use case. If your user base is somewhere, let's say you have servers in US, but the user base is mostly in Australia. So you can easily send traffic from Australia to the servers which are in US. So you can very much achieve that in cloud. It all depends on where are you provisioning your load generators and controllers. You have the server, you can provision those servers and you can do that.
Yeah, and one more thing, like there will be like only one chance. It will be like only we can pass it as a web URLs and web custom requests, right? If it is in LoadRunner, otherwise you will directly pass as a GET or POST. So we will directly put the body over there, and
you
can
configure that in JMeter as well. In JMeter, you can configure that. In LoadRunner, you can configure that. So either you get a web URL or you get an API. That's how you test. That's how that testing doesn't change. Okay.
Okay. Thanks.
Sure. I've got a question from Vikas. Are we going to cover JMeter integration with Eclipse? DevOps section, we are going to cover Jenkins with JMeter. Eclipse, IntelliJ Eclipse is a, you know, it's IDE, right? So we'll be going to cover how do you integrate Jenkins with JMeter? How do you create performance job? If you look at my slide here, I have talked about how do you create JMeter job in Jenkins? And that too, you need to trigger it automatically, right? So that's what we'll be covering in a DevOps section, Jenkins section. Satish has given me, It is possible to complete the course bit early by increasing session duration per day. It really helps. I can do that, Satish. I can do that. I can go for 1.5 hours. But again, that is not planned. That you are proposing right now. So depends on the participants, how they are comfortable. I have got reviews from participants that please have it for 1 hour. We cannot take it more. Something like that. I have also got the review. So it all depends on the group once it forms, and then we can take it forward. Can you please give some plans and touch up on JMeter?
Roshan, I have one question. Okay. Do we cover? Hello.
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. Are we covering the shell scripting stuff in this?
Yes. Shell scripting. We have a complete session on Linux command line that you see here. Once you understand Linux command line, we'll be covering shell scripting for the performance monitoring point of view, not from an automation point of view. So we'll understand how do you performance monitor the during the test duration that you need to capture, right? CPU, memory, disk. How would you keep collecting the information for the entire test duration? We'll be writing shell scripting for that.
Okay. And databases? Which databases we are covering?
No, databases we are not covering here. It's not possible. Again, I can give you a brief glance of it. What all databases has to offer in AWS? I can give you a brief glance, but if you're talking about tuning and all, that will take another 2 months. It's a very huge topic, database tuning, right? It's a very huge topic. You need to talk about, let's say, what if it's Oracle, you need to talk about SQL tuning. You need to talk about your database performance. You need to talk about AWR report. You need to first understand Oracle, install Oracle. There's a lot more. If I talk about MongoDB, same thing goes for you. You need to talk about indexing. It's a very lengthy topic. You cannot have it.
I'm not talking about the optimization, but the connections in a cloud, that how to
how to set up database. Yeah. Very easy in cloud. I can show you that.
Only that much.
It's very simple. I can show you that. That's not a problem at all. Okay, I have got a questions from some glance and touch upon JMeter. So it's not a JMeter course, son. Okay, I cannot teach you correlation here. Okay, it's not a JMeter course. Okay. So I can. You will understand how do we integrate Jenkins with JMeter here. Okay, touch up means I can just. I can just tell you something, but I'm not going to go in detail about JMeter. It's not a JMeter course. Okay, I have got a few more questions. Satish, is it possible to complete? Okay, Satish, I have answered that question. Mitali, will this be a hands-on? Yes, completely hands-on. Completely hands-on, Mitali. So that is the reason it takes so long, around 2 months for sure. Because whatever I speak, you will see that. I'm not going to just talk EBS, EFS, and S3. I'm going to show you what the importance of EBS, EFS, all the ages. I'm gonna show everything in Cloud Console. I'm gonna make everyone have this account, AWS account with you. And then I'm going to show each and everything. Like someone was asking about cloud. If you look at the cloud services, okay, here, it has a lot more things to offer. Let's say RDS, it's a relational database. What AWS does that, they give you all the options in the world to have an RDS instance. Like let's say, not just the Oracle database or the MySQL. It has given me all the options for RDS. I'm going to show you how do we do that work. So you have the options like Aurora, MySQL, MariaDB, PostgreSQL, Oracle, SQL Server, in the RDS space. There are some, similarly, there are other kinds of databases as well. So a lot more things in database. I'm going to show each and everything hands-on. You will be able to architect a solution in cloud after that, Amitani.
Roshan, Abhishek said, so are we using that paid services or free services in Amazon?
No, this is a free tier. I'll be using EKS as well, which is not free, because I have to demonstrate that EKS is not free, right? So we'll be using mostly free tier, but I'll be demonstrating which is not free tier as well. But if you want to practice, you will have to do that as well. EKS
Yes.
Elastic Kubernetes Service is not free.
So we can not use as a free, yeah?
It's not free. AWS doesn't give it for free. So you can use it. You have to pay your bill. You will get a bill generated. You will have to pay the bill, right? If AWS doesn't give it for free, then what's the point discussing? You have to pay, right?
Yeah, I understood that. But like some in this course, whatever services we use, that will be free, right?
Correct. It is free for a lot many times. Okay, it's free tier. It's a free tier. You give 750 hours of free. Okay, in AWS itself, AWS free tier.
Right. Based on usage, it is free.
Yes, based on usage. So 750 hours, I think it's free. But after that, if you want to use that, it will not be free. You will be charged. So it depends on your usage. Okay. So yes, as someone mentioned.
Yeah.
Mostly it will be free services. Okay. So don't worry about that. There are always free services, 12 months free. So it depends. So 750 hours of compute. So you can just go over this link. You can store till 5 GB in S3 bucket. You can use RDS for 750 hours, Amazon EC2 for 750 hours per month, 12 months free. So these are the free. But if you will exceed this free tier, you will be billed. Will you be covering typical performances on cloud and how debug using profilers monitoring? See, again, profilers, we talk about Java. Okay, what is profiler? I will talk about how do we architect solution in cloud. That's important. That's the focus here, Mithali. If you're talking about monitoring, I'll be showing you CloudWatch container insights. But if we're talking about profilers, so you profile one application, right? Java type of application. That's Java profiling. That's not covered here. It's not part of this course. I'll be showing you what cloud has to offer for monitoring. I will be definitely showing you that.
Yeah. One doubt. Actually, our main focus based on all the clouds, right? Based on the solution architect, what we are talking, right? So if we complete this course, so we can change our profile to solution architect. Is it possible?
Architect, you will have to learn. See, you will be growing a lot more in performance engineering field, or you can be a cloud engineer. If you see, this is about Kubernetes. I'm not just talking about cloud here. Okay, cloud is a module in my course here. You need to understand this. Cloud is a module in my test. I'm just covering cloud till this point of time here. I'm not just talking about cloud always here, the entire 2 months. I'm talking about shell scripting. I'm talking about containers. I'm talking about Kubernetes. You will move towards DevOps, I would say.
Yeah,
you will
exactly. Yeah, got it.
DevOps engineer. You would be a performance DevOps engineer.
Yeah, got it. Thank
a
you.
Performance engineer who can do DevOps work as well.
DevOps,
you can create CI/CD pipeline. You would move towards that.
Yeah. So it like complete architecture we will be handling without help from any other DevOps. So as a performance engineer, we should know about the in and out about the architecture as well as we try to build on all the cloud platforms. Also, we'll be well versed, right?
Yes. That's all you will get. You can easily fill into DevOps role. You can understand what DevOps are doing in your organization, and you can be very much comfortable working with DevOps, or you can take DevOps role as well. You can do Kubernetes setup, cloud monitoring of Kubernetes. You can do everything here.
Thank you.
Yes. Will you be doing hands-on during it? Yes, Mithali. It's complete hands-on training. What's the point if I'm doing it on my own hands-on? I'll be demonstrating everything here, and that is the reason it takes long. Okay, Mithali. Yeah, I'll be doing during the training itself, hands-on. Yes, you are right. During hands-on, yes, you can contact me if you have any questions. You can practice. You will have the videos with you, recorded videos. You can practice, and if you have questions, there will be a WhatsApp group. Closed group, you can ping me directly. We can connect over weekend. If you have questions, you can call me. We can discuss over phone. All those things will be done. Yeah, feel free to speak, ask your questions. Okay. We'll be starting with the real demo from tomorrow. You can attend demos from tomorrow. You'd understand how I go about things. Okay. Looks like we are good. I do not see any more questions. If I missed any questions, please let me know. Please speak. I'm looking on the chat window. I don't think I have missed anything. Okay, I have answered most of the questions. Okay, looks like we are good and we are top of our hour. So thank you everyone for joining. We'll see you in the next demo session. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Thank you so much, bro.
Yeah, thank you.